Intel is making headlines again, but not the kind you expect from a tech company. Semiconductors, and especially manufacturing, has become a strategic question and politics are getting involved. There's a lot of noise surrounding Intel at the moment. In this video, we will cut through the noise by focusing on what really matters, the silicon. We will look at Intel's latest chips, Panther Lake and Clearwater Forest, and of course, 18A. The process node that Pat Gelsinger once said he bet the entire company on. Can chips made in USA be competitive again? And what's the current state of Intel? Let's find out. I was fortunate enough to attend Intel's tech tour in Arizona, where we not only got a preview of Panther Lake and Clearwater Forest, but were invited to visit Intel's Fab 52. That's where 18A is manufactured. The first production-ready process node that combines two key next-gen technologies, gate all-around transistors and backside power delivery networks. On paper, the most advanced process node in the world, made in Arizona. Both Panther Lake and Clearwater Forest are built on 18A, at least in part. To understand what that means for Intel, we first have to understand how these new chips work. And that's exactly what we will do. As always, I've put chapters in the video description below, so you can skip to the parts that interest you the most. At first glance, Panther Lake seems like a simple successor to last year's Lunar Lake. It's a mobile SoC with a focus on high-end, thin and light systems. But there are two major differences between Lunar Lake and the new Panther Lake that change the entire equation. First, unlike Lunar Lake, Panther Lake comes in different variants. And by that, I don't mean different versions based on the same silicon, but variants with different silicon. And second, Intel is starting to use Intel Foundry again. Lunar Lake and Arrow Lake were entirely built on TSMC, at least when it comes to the active silicon. And a lot of people took that as a sign of the beginning of the end for Intel Foundry. Panther Lake is reversing this trend. Both of these changes are so important because they tell us a lot about the current state of Intel. Panther Lake has many faces. Three, in fact. There are three distinct variants of Panther Lake, each with a different combination of silicon. Let me explain. Ever since Meteor Lake, Intel tried to implement its disaggregated tile-based design philosophy. The idea is simple. A chip is split up in different parts, Intel calls them tiles, and those parts are then mixed and matched to build the perfect chip for each individual use case. High-end CPU with entry-level GPU, or the other way around, different I/O options, all possible with this concept. A bit like AMD's chiplets, but less focused on pure cost savings and more on creating specialized chips and easy to swap IP. It's a toolbox with prefabricated chip parts. For Panther Lake, this toolbox contains six different active tiles. A small and a large compute tile with different CPU core configurations, a small and a large GPU tile with different GPU core configurations, and a small and a large platform controller tile with, you guessed it, different I/O configurations. Each variant of Panther Lake is based on a combination of these six tiles. First, there's Panther Lake U. It combines the three smallest tiles into the smallest possible variant of Panther Lake. The small compute tile comes with four of the new Cougar Cove D cores with 12 megabytes of L3 cache and four Darkmount E cores on a separate low power island called low power E cores. The small GPU tile has four of Intel's new Xe3 Celestial GPU cores, and the small platform controller tile offers PCI Express Gen 4 and Gen 5, Thunderbolt 4, plenty of USB and of course Wi-Fi 7. All you need in a modern mobile SoC. Next, there's Panther Lake H. It combines the large compute tile with the small GPU tile and the large platform controller tile, which is an interesting but smart combination. Compared to the small compute tile, the large compute tile of Panther Lake H keeps the same four Cougar Cove P cores, but adds eight Darkmount E cores directly to the P core fabric. Not only does this increase the shared L3 cache to 18 megabytes, which benefits all cores connected to the fabric, but you have to remember that with SkyMount last year, Intel's E cores got a massive IPC boost. And Darkmount is the successor to SkyMount. While Darkmount cores are still E cores, and they are certainly slower than a Cougar Cove P core, eight additional Darkmount cores add a substantial amount of multithread performance. And because these cores are attached to the P-core fabric, they are faster than the same Darkmon cores on the low power island, which the large compute tile also still has. In total, it's a 4 plus 8 plus 4 core configuration, with a lot more CPU performance than the small compute tile. But why combine the large compute tile with the small GPU tile? That's because Panther Lake H is meant for systems that come with a discrete mobile GPU. The small GPU tile is plenty enough for all your basic GPU needs when the main GPU is turned off to save power. But as soon as you need real GPU performance, the discrete GPU will take over. Using the large GPU tile would just be a waste of silicon. And to accommodate the external GPU, Panther Lake H uses the large platform controller tile, which offers 8 additional PCI Express 5.0 lanes, exactly the amount needed to connect a modern mobile GPU, perfectly optimized. Last but not least, there's Panther Lake H12XE. This version combines the large compute tile with the large GPU tile and the small platform controller tile. And this time the large GPU tile is actually large, with 12XE3 cores, 3 times the amount of the small GPU tile and 50% more than what Lunar Lake offered. Because this variant of Panther Lake is meant for systems without a discrete GPU, hence the use of the large GPU tile, this variant uses the small platform controller tile, just like Panther Lake U, because it doesn't need the additional PCIe Gen 5 lanes to connect to a discrete GPU. Again, perfectly optimized. Lunar Lake was a great chip, but it was a compromise, because there was only one variant, the silicon had to strike a balance. 4 plus 4 CPU cores and an 8 core GPU was the result. With Panther Lake, Intel doesn't have to compromise anymore. All three Panther Lake variants are designed for a specific purpose. Panther Lake U is the new entry-level chip. It has the same 4 plus 4 CPU core configuration as Lunar Lake, with slightly improved core architecture, but a smaller 4-core GPU, which is great because not every laptop is used for gaming or graphics-intensive applications. Like I said, Intel doesn't have to compromise anymore. The Panther Lake entry-level chip is actually entry-level. The same goes for Panther Lake H12XE. It combines the large 4 plus 8 plus 4 compute tile with the much bigger 12-core GPU tile, a lot more powerful than Lunar Lake and, as the name implies, a successor to Arrow Lake H. And if you are an OEM building a system with a discrete mobile GPU, you just take the standard Panther Lake H. It comes with the same powerful CPU on the large compute tile, but the small GPU tile, because you don't need more than that. And it has the large platform controller tile, so you can connect a GPU and a Gen 5 SSD at the same time. That's exactly what Intel has been talking about for over 5 years now. Disaggregated design. It's finally here. And not just on paper, but as it was originally intended. Meteor Lake was the prototype, and it kind of failed. Limited release on mobile, never released on desktop. After Meteor Lake, Intel split the architectures, which goes against the entire idea of disaggregation. Lunar Lake was a one-off specialized design for mobile, and with CPU and GPU on the same tile, almost monolithic in nature. A great chip, but not disaggregated. And the same is true for Arrow Lake, which is tile-based, but doesn't really take advantage of it. The only cool thing is that Arrow Lake H reuses the Meteor Lake SoC tile, but that's about it. Intel had this really cool design concept for years, but first it failed and then it was only partially implemented. Until now. Panther Lake is the first generation that uses Intel tile-based design in a meaningful way. And that's a big deal. It shows that Intel is back on track with its original vision. Of course, we have to wait and see how the next-gen desktop chips will turn out before we can make a full assessment. The ultimate goal would be shared tile usage between mobile and desktop chips, but the signs are looking good. The second important aspect of Panther Lake is the process nodes. As a tile-based design, each tile can be manufactured in a different node, and that includes different foundries. Which is great because it allows you to select the best process node for each tile. Looking at Lunar and Arrow Lake, all the active tiles were produced by TSMC. Yes, the base tile interposer was manufactured on an Intel node, and Intel used its in-house Foveros packaging technology. But that was it. Panther Lake is changing that in a meaningful way. Both variants of the Panther Lake compute tile are always produced in Intel's new 18A node. That means that no matter if you buy a Panther Lake with the small or the large compute tile, there will always be 18A silicon on your chip. But what about the other tiles? The platform controller tile is always produced by TSMC. Both variants, the small and the large one, are fabricated using N6. Intel likely has long-term contracts and it does make sense to use the already booked capacity. Plus, N6 is a pretty cheap and high-yielding node. The GPU tile is more interesting. It comes in two flavors. The small GPU tile is produced in Intel 3, while the large GPU tile uses TSMC's N3E. That means the amount of Intel Foundry and external silicon changes based on each variant. Panther Lake U and H both combine an Intel 18A compute tile with an Intel 3 GPU tile and a TSMC N6 platform controller tile. Only on Panther Lake H12XE, both the GPU tile and the platform controller tile are from TSMC. But even here, the majority of the silicon is from Intel Foundry. And that's still true when we exclude the interposer and any filler tiles. The large 18A compute tile has a die size of 114.36 square millimeters, which is more area than the 53.95 square millimeter large GPU tile and the 49.04 square millimeter large platform controller tile combined. Even if Panther Lake H12XE would use the large platform controller tile, 18A would still account for over 50% of the silicon area. No matter which Panther Lake variant you buy, the majority of the active silicon is always from Intel Foundry. And it's always 18A. A massive step for Intel and a reversal of what we saw with Lunar and Arrow Lake. Panther Lake shows a new Intel. Finally, we are getting a truly disaggregated design and Intel Foundry is once again majority supplier of the active silicon. But there's another product that, in my opinion, is even more impressive than Panther Lake. Of course, I'm talking about Clearwater Forest, Intel's next-gen E-core server CPU. On the surface, Clearwater Forest might not look like much, but below there's a lot going on. What you are looking at right now is a combination of 17 active tiles produced in three different nodes and connected with two different types of packaging technology. And all of it is Intel. Let's unpack. The star of the show are the 12 compute tiles. Each compute tile contains 6 Darkmont quad-core clusters. And because 6 times 4 is 24, a single compute tile has 24 Darkmont cores. If you do the math, 12 compute tiles with 24 cores each is 288 cores in total. And each of these 12 compute tiles is produced in 18A, which makes sense because the cores are where you want to use the best process node available to achieve the highest efficiency and performance possible. But what if I told you that the compute tiles aren't even the most impressive part of this chip? The foundation of Clearwater Forest are the three active base tiles. And the important part here is the word active, because we aren't just talking about passive silicon interposers like Intel has used in the past. These base tiles are produced in Intel 3 and they contain a lot of active silicon. The memory system, for example, with DDR5 memory PHYs and controllers. But most importantly, they contain cache. A lot of cache. 192 megabytes of last level cache per base tile, to be precise. That's a total of 576 megabytes across all three of them. 576 megabytes. Yes, that much. It's a last level cache because Intel's E-cores, and that includes Darkmont, only has a shared L2 cache on each E-core cluster. They don't have an L3 cache. So the cache in the base tiles is a bit like a L3 cache, but not exactly. Calling it last level cache makes sense. And because Intel thought that 576 megabytes of cache in the base tiles isn't cool enough, they connected the compute tiles to the base tiles via Foveros Direct 3D, which is Intel's fancy marketing name for hybrid bonding. Yes, the same technology that AMD uses for its 3D V-cache, only packaged by Intel Foundry. Each base tile is hybrid bonded to 4 of the 18A compute tiles we just talked about. Compute tiles on top, base tiles below. It's an insane setup. The chip is completed with its 2 I/O tiles left and right of the base tiles. And the cool part is, these are the same I/O tiles Intel has been using on their previous Xeon 6 CPUs. It's a reuse of tiles. Exactly what I want to see. Disaggregated design in action, just like with Panther Lake. The base tiles and the I/O tiles are connected via Intel's EMIB, which uses small embedded silicon bridges. Like TSMC's Foveros L, for example, which caused a lot of trouble for NVIDIA's Blackwell last year. Intel is going all out with Clearwater Forest. Compared to the previous generation, Sierra Forest, Clearwater Forest is a massive upgrade. Not only does it double the cores from 144 to 288, but the core architecture also gets a major update. That's because Sierra Forest came out before Skymont, and still uses the much slower Crestmont E cores. Clearwater Forest has twice the cores and each core has a much higher IPC. And they are getting a process node upgrade too, going from Intel 3 to 18A. Plus there's the massive 576 MB of cache on top, or rather below. I can't overstate how insane this chip is, and by insane I mean insanely good. Clearwater Forest has the potential to put Intel back on top, even if Zen 6 turns out to be amazing. It will be a close fight for sure. And most importantly, Clearwater Forest shows that Intel is executing again. They are not content with competing for second place, like in the last couple of years. Both Panther Lake and Clearwater Forest are signs of a new Intel, made with 18A. And 18A has to work, both for Intel and to show potential Intel Foundry customers that the next-gen 14A node is worth designing for. During the Intel Tech Tour in Arizona, myself and many others were invited to visit Fab 52. If you don't know how big of a deal that is, you might think it's normal, but giving so many people access to a fab, and especially to your most advanced fab, is unheard of. It shows two things. First, Intel needs the world to know about 18A. And second, that production is in full swing. I visited Fab 52 in late September, and by now Intel should be starting high volume manufacturing. Because Panther Lake and Clearwater Forest don't work without 18A. It's clear that Intel has a high confidence in the node. At the same time, all three 18A chips are very manageable when it comes to die size. Intel is currently producing the Clearwater Forest compute tile and both the small and the large Panther Lake compute tiles in 18A. It does make a lot of sense to start with smaller chips. That's true for every new node, and especially a node that introduces two major new technologies. Both gate-all-around transistors and backside power delivery aren't an easy feat. It will take time and Intel will learn a lot. The truth is, you can see the yield when you tour a fab. But the truth is also that Intel wouldn't be able to launch Panther Lake and Clearwater Forest if the yield was as low as some have claimed. My guess is that by now Intel is getting over 60% yield on the large Panther Lake compute tile. But that's just that, a guess. And there are other ways to think about the state of 18A. Lunar Lake is produced in TSMC's N3B. Still a high-end process node. If 18A would perform worse, I don't think Intel would release a direct successor on 18A, especially since the small 18A compute tile on Panther Lake U comes with the exact same CPU core configuration as Lunar Lake on N3B, perfect for a direct comparison, even with the differences in memory, which Intel knows. It tells me that Intel is confident about 18A, confident enough to compare it to TSMC's 3nm class node. We won't know for sure how 18A performs until we have the first silicon in our hands. And I wouldn't put too much focus on clock speeds, but on area efficiency and power per area. Backside power delivery is changing heat transfer, and a new transistor type needs time to develop. Feature size and efficiency will be the metrics to judge 18A on. So what's the current state of Intel? If you ask me, it's a lot better than just a year ago. Both Panther Lake and Clearwater Forest are signs that Intel is executing again. Both chips follow a clear and efficient design philosophy. Disaggregation has finally arrived. Panther Lake and especially Clearwater Forest are the most exciting Intel chips in recent years. Intel wants to compete again, and both products do have a good chance of being more than just competitive. As for 18A, right now the most advanced chips do come from Arizona, at least when we look at high volume manufacturing. TSMC's N2 will be the true competitor, and it also comes with the new transistor type, but without backside power delivery. TSMC is a bit more conservative. I think the stars are looking good for 18A. And with everything Intel will learn from this node, 14A has a really good shot at becoming a true leading-edge process node. All Intel needs now are customers, and I'm confident there will be plenty. Just as chips made in USA will make a comeback. I hope you found this video interesting and see you in the next one.